स्टूडेंट्स, आई राजेश्वरी शिरकनहली वेलकम यू ऑल इन नागेशकरस की ऑर्किड स्कूल चैनल। स्टूडेंट्स, इन द लास्ट चैप्टर, दैट इज चैप्टर नंबर 8, वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट मोशन। वी हैव सीन दैट मोशन इज रिलेटिव, मीन्स डिपेंड्स ऑन द ऑब्जर्वर। फॉर वन पर्सन, वन पर्टिकुलर ऑब्जेक्ट इज इन मोशन, एंड फॉर द अदर दैट ऑब्जेक्ट मे बी एट रेस्ट। सो वी हैव discussed about motion, the different equations which are called as equations of motion, which are also called as kinematic equations. We have discussed about three equations, that is v is equal to u plus at, then s is equal to ut plus half at square, and v square minus u square is equal to 2as. Now we are going to start chapter number 9. In that we are going to discuss about force and laws of motion. Okay, so we will see what are the laws of motion and how the force is responsible for the motion to take place. So let's begin with chapter number 9. The name of the chapter is force and laws of motion. So let's begin. In the previous chapter we described the motion of an object along a straight line in terms of its position, velocity and acceleration, isn't it? In last chapter we have discussed about motion of the object along a straight line, which is called as linear motion. We have described this motion of an object in a straight line in terms of the position of the object, the velocity which it acquires and the acceleration. We saw that such a motion can be uniform or non-uniform. So we have also discussed about the types of motion, that is uniform motion and non-uniform motion. What is uniform motion? If the object covers equal distances in equal intervals of time, that is called as uniform motion. And non-uniform motion means if the object covers unequal distances in equal intervals of time, then it is called as non-uniform motion. We have not yet discovered what causes the motion. Okay, so in last chapter we have seen about the motion of different objects, but why do they move? How do they move? What is the factor which makes the objects to move? Okay, so we have not discovered what causes the motion. Why does the speed of an object change with time? Okay, an object moving can change the speed. Sometimes it increases, sometimes it decreases the speed. Even the moving object can come to rest. Do all motions require a cause? If so, what is the nature of this cause? Okay, so all you have learnt actually in standard 8 that there is a factor which is responsible for the motion of objects. So all the motions require that cause, that factor. Then what is that cause actually? What is the nature of that cause? In this chapter we shall learn, we shall make an attempt to quench all such curiosities. So we are going to seek the answers of all these questions. We are going to discuss about that important cause which makes the objects move. Okay. For many centuries, the problem of motion and its causes had puzzled scientists and philosophers. So for n number of the years, for many centuries, the scientists and philosophers were not knowing exactly the problem of motion and the cause behind the motion. A ball on the ground, when given a small hit, does not move forever, isn't it? If suppose there is a ball on the ground which is at rest, means which is not moving, when you hit it, it gets motion, it starts moving, but it does not move forever, it moves to a small distance and then it stops. Such observations suggest that rest is the natural state of an object. Okay, until and unless we make the objects move, they do not move, they remain at their rest position. So rest is called as the natural state of an object. This remained the belief until Galileo Galilei and Isaac Newton developed an entirely different approach to understand the motion. Okay, so natural state of an object is rest. This was the belief, but later on two scientists, they are Galileo Galilei and Isaac Newton. What they did? They developed an entirely different approach to understand the motion. Now, here in this figure you can see some of the different figures are shown. Here the trolley moves along the direction we push it. Okay, in this figure you can see the trolley moves along the direction we push it. Then here pushing is going on. This is an activity, pushing. And here the drawer is pulled. So, here what is the activity? Pulling. And here in the C figure, the hockey stick hits the ball forward. Means here the activity taking place is hitting, pushing, pulling, hitting. These are some of the activities which are used for making the object move. So, pushing, pulling or hitting objects change their state of motion. Okay, so you have learned about this in standard 8. A push, a pull, hit. These are some of the activities, some of the actions which are required for changing the state of motion. In our everyday life, we observe that some efforts is required to put a stationary object into motion or to stop a moving object. So, in day-to-day life, we see that we have to take some effort for moving an object which is at rest. Stationary object means which is not moving, which is steady, which is at rest. So, to make that object move, we have to take some efforts. Or suppose an object is moving, for stopping that also we have to take some effort. We ordinarily experience this as a muscular effort and say that we must push or hit or pull on an object to change its state of motion. Isn't it? Just now I showed you a few figures in which pushing, pulling, hitting, these actions are shown. So, we ordinarily experience that this is a muscular effort. Pushing, pulling, lifting, kicking, all these are the muscular efforts. We use the muscles of our body, isn't it, to push or hit or pull on an object for changing the state of that object. The concept of force is based on this push, hit or pull. Do you remember, you have learnt in standard 8 that force is nothing but a push or a pull. So, force is the concept used for describing these all the actions, that is pushing, pulling, hitting, lifting and so on. Let us now ponder about a force. What is it? In fact, no one has seen, we cannot see the force, tasted or felt a force, isn't it? We don't see the force, we don't taste or feel the force. But we can definitely see the effects of the force. The force, whatever effects it causes on the object, those effects can be seen. However, we always see or feel the effect of a force. Okay, last year you have learned about the different effects of force. Force is used to set an object in motion. Force is used to stop a moving object. Force is used to change the speed, that is to increase or decrease the speed. Then force is used to change the direction of the motion of object, and force is used to change the shape of the object. So, after knowing all this, let us discuss more about the force. It can only be explained by describing what happens when a force is applied to an object. Okay, so, we cannot see the force, but we can see the effect caused by that force on any particular object on which the force is exerting. Pushing, hitting and pulling of objects are all ways of bringing objects in motion. Okay, just now you saw those figures, pushing a trolley, pulling a drawer, or the hitting the ball. These all are the sum of ways of bringing the objects in motion. They move because we make a force act on them. Okay, so we apply the force actually when we push, pull, hit, kick, lift, whatever actions we do actually, what we do is we apply force on the objects and we make those objects move. So, this is the force which acts on the objects, and because of this force the objects start moving. From your studies in earlier classes, you are all familiar with the fact that a force can be used to change the magnitude of velocity of an object, that is to make the object move faster or slower, isn't it? By using the magnitude of, changing the magnitude of velocity, we can make the object move faster or slower, or even to change its direction of motion. We also know that a force can change the shape and size of the objects. So, all these such actions are shown here in figure 9.2. See the figure A, a spring expands on application of force. This is an original spring. When you stretch that, you can see this is an expanded force, expanded spring. So, you can expand a spring by stretching it. You stretch means what you do exactly? You apply the force on that spring. Similarly, you can compress also by pressing it. So, pressing is also again one kind of force. In the next figure, you can see a spherical rubber ball. This is an original spherical rubber ball and it becomes oblong. The shape of this rubber ball changes when we apply force on it. Okay, so, when we take that ball in between our two palms and we apply force in opposite direction, which are shown here by arrows, means the palms are applying force towards the ball, okay, towards those palms are applying the forces towards each other, that is towards the ball, means here the direction of force is opposite to each other. As a result, what happens here? The shape of the ball gets changed. So, here we can see pushing, pulling, then hitting, then stretching and pressing. All these are the types of the actions and these all are the examples of the force applied, and we see the different changes in the object. The objects are set into motion, the objects are stopped, the objects are, you know, their speed is changed, then shape is changed, direction is changed and so on. Now, after discussing this all the introductory part, let us move to the first concept of the chapter, that is types of the forces, that is balanced and unbalanced forces. Now, the next figure, that is figure 9.3, shows a wooden block on a horizontal table. There are two strings X and Y which are tied to the two opposite faces of the blocks. Okay, in the figure there is a wooden block which is kept on the table. There are two strings used X and Y which are tied to the opposite faces of the block. If we apply a force by pulling the string X, the block begins to move to the right. Similarly, if we pull the string Y, the block moves to the left. But if the block is pulled from both the sides with equal forces, the block will not move. Such forces are called balanced forces and do not change the state of rest or of motion of an object. Okay, so just look at the figure 8.3. See here, this is figure 8.3. The two forces are acting on a wooden block. This is an wooden block placed and there are two strings which are X and Y. If you pull the string X, the block moves in this direction, that is towards the right. And if you pull Y, then the block starts moving in reverse direction, that is it moves in this direction, that is towards the left. But if you pull both the strings with the same force, then what is the resultant force? It is 0, net force is 0, and the result is there is no motion of this object. The object remains at the same place. So, such forces are called as balanced forces. And they do not change the state of rest or of motion of an object. So, object which is in which state, it remains in the same state. Okay, so state of rest or of motion of an object do not get changed when balanced forces act on that object. Now, let us consider a situation in which two opposite forces of different magnitudes pull the block. Okay, suppose now there are two forces and they apply the forces which are not equal in magnitude, means one string is pulled more and the other string is not pulled with that much force. Then let us see what happens in such situation. In this case, the block would begin to move in the direction of the greater force. Okay, for example, suppose here the X string applies more force on the wooden block as compared to Y string, then the block will move towards X. And if Y will apply more force than X on the wooden block, then the string will move towards Y. So, it moves in the direction of the greater force. Thus, the two forces are not balanced here. Okay, one is applying more force and the other one is less force, means these are not balanced and the result is there is change in the state of motion or change of rest. So, thus two forces are not balanced and the unbalanced force acts in the direction the block moves. This suggests that an unbalanced force acting on an object brings it in motion. The balanced forces do not cause any change in the state of rest or of motion, and whereas unbalanced forces acting on an object brings it in motion. So, that is what shown here in this figure. Okay. Now, what happens when some children try to push a box on a rough floor? So, what happens when the children try to push the box on a rough floor? So, see here in this figure 9.4, you can see there are three situations shown, that is A, B and C. Let us see these all the three situations in detail. Okay, if they push box with a small force, the box does not move. Okay, if the box is very heavy and if it is pushed with a very small force, then what's the result? The box does not move because of friction acting in a direction opposite to the push. So, you have learned about friction, which is also a force, which is called as frictional force or force of friction. You have learnt about it in your 8th standard. So, if a small force is applied, then because of the friction between the box and the floor, the box does not move. That is what showed in the first figure. This friction force arises between two surfaces in contact. In this case, between the bottom of the box and the floor's rough surface. So, you know that friction or frictional force is the force which exists in between the two surfaces which are in contact with each other. Now, here which are the two surfaces in contact with each other? One is the floor's rough surface on which the box is kept, and the second surface is the bottom of the box. So, there is a force of friction between these two surfaces. It balances the pushing force and therefore, the box does not move. Okay, so, here two forces are acting together. One is the force applied by the children for pushing that box, and the other force is the frictional force which get balanced with each other, and as a result there is no movement in the box. It remains as it is. Now, the second figure, that is 9.4b, in that figure what is showed, the children push the box harder, but the box still does not move. Okay, in the second situation, what the children are doing, they are trying to push the box more harder, but still the box does not move. This is because the frictional force or friction force still balances the pushing force. मीन्स हियर द पुशिंग फोर्स इज नॉट इनफ टू कॉज एनी मोशन इन द बॉक्स. सो स्टिल द फोर्स ऑफ फ्रिक्शन इज प्रेजेंट एंड अगेन हियर द फोर्स ऑफ फ्रिक्शन एंड द पुशिंग फोर्स गेट बैलेंस्ड विथ ईच अदर. इफ द चिल्ड्रन पुश द बॉक्स हार्डर स्टिल द पुशिंग फोर्स बिकम्स बिगर दैन द फ्रिक्शन फोर्स दैट इज शोन इन द थर्ड फिगर. सो हियर द बॉक्स इज पुश्ड विथ इवन मोर फोर्स. देन वॉट हैपन्स इन सच सिचुएशन द पुशिंग फोर्स बिकम्स बिगर दैन द फ्रिक्शन फोर्स. सो देर इज एन अनबैलेंस्ड फोर्स. सो द बॉक्स स्टार्ट्स मूविंग इजंट इट. I will show you all those three figures once again. Just see. See, these are the three situations shown here. In the first situation, you can see these two children are trying to push the box. They are trying to push the box means they are applying a pushing force. But there is a friction force and these two forces get balanced with each other. So, box does not move. Now, in the second situation, the children are applying more force. So, there is more pushing force, but still the force of friction present and these two forces again balance with each other and as a result, the box still does not move. And whereas in the third situation, more force is applied. So, pushing force is greater than the frictional force here in this case. Okay. So, as this pushing force is greater than the frictional force, as a result, the box moves in this direction. So, in these three situations, what we see is in first situation, when the children starts pushing the box, there is a force of friction present which balances with this pushing force. So, as a result, the box does not move. In the second situation, children have pushed the box more harder, but still there is presence of force of friction and because of this there is no motion, no movement of the box, it remains as it is. And whereas in the third situation, what happens? The children push the box even more harder and here the pushing force becomes more than the friction force. So, as a result, the box starts moving. Now, let us see another example. What happens when we ride a bicycle? When we stop pedaling, the bicycle begins to slow down, isn't it? What happens when we ride a bicycle? We start pedaling and bicycle is set into motion. But when we stop pedaling, the bicycle begins to slow down. This is again because of the friction forces acting opposite to the direction of motion. Okay, so when we stop pedaling, why the bicycle starts slowing down? Because there is a force of friction present which is acting in the opposite direction of the motion of bicycle. So, there is a friction in between the wheels of the bicycle and the road. In order to keep the bicycle moving, we have to start pedaling again. It thus appears that an object maintains its motion under the continuous application of an unbalanced force. So, this is an unbalanced force which causes the motion of the objects. So, objects maintains its position under the continuous application of such unbalanced forces. However, it is quite incorrect. An object moves with a uniform velocity when the forces, that is pushing force and frictional force acting on the object are balanced and there is no net external force on it. Okay, so what is the fact? The fact is lying in that the object moves with uniform velocity when both the forces, that is pushing force and frictional force acting on the object are balanced and that is why there is no net external force acting on the object. If an unbalanced force is applied on the object, there will be a change either in its speed or in the direction of motion. So, if the balanced force is there, there is no change in the motion of the object. But if suppose there is an unbalanced force acting, then what is the result? There will be a change either in the speed of the object or in the direction of the motion of objects. Thus, to accelerate the motion of an object, an unbalanced force is required. Okay, so unbalanced force is responsible for the motion of an object, and the change in its speed or the change in the direction of motion would continue as long as this unbalanced force is applied. So, until and unless there is unbalanced force, there is no change in the motion or direction of the object. However, if this force which is applied is completely removed, then the object would continue to move with the velocity it has acquired till then. Okay, when object is moving, if suppose we remove the force completely, then also the object would continue to move with the velocity which it has acquired till then. Okay, so because of the unbalanced force, the object is set into motion. So, students, we have discussed and differentiated the balanced and unbalanced forces. Now, let us discuss about the laws of motion. What is the first law? By observing the motion of objects on an inclined plane, Galileo deduced that objects move with a constant speed when no force acts on them. So, what Galileo did? He observed the motion of the objects on an inclined plane, and he said that objects move with constant speed when no force acts on them. He observed that when a marble rolls down an inclined plane, its velocity increases. Okay, so that is what shown here in this figure. You can see the first figure. Here this is an inclined plane and this is a marble kept. Then this marble inclined down through this inclined plane, means it rolled down. Okay. In the next chapter, you will learn that the marble falls under the unbalanced force of gravity as it rolls down and attains a definite velocity by the time it reaches the bottom. So, in the next chapter, that is in the chapter of gravitation, you are going to study more about this unbalanced force of gravity. So, you are going to learn that marble falls under the unbalanced force of gravity as it rolls down and attains a definite velocity by the time it reaches the bottom. Its velocity decreases when it climbs up as shown in the second figure. So, just look at the second figure. Here this when this rolled marble tries to climb in the opposite direction, the direction of this marble is in the opposite of this marble. So, during such type the velocity decreases. Then figure 9.5c shows a marble resting on an inclined, on an ideal frictionless plane inclined on both the sides. Okay, so the third figure, this figure shows that these are the two inclined planes and there is continuous motion. Here A is in the downward motion, B is in the upward motion, and whereas in the C it is on a double inclined plane. This is in the downward, this is in the upward, and here there is a double inclined plane. So, what happens in such a double inclined plane? It shows a marble resting on an ideal frictionless plane inclined on both the sides. So, here it is inclined on both the sides, and in such case the marble rests on frictionless plane. Okay? Galileo argued that when the marble is released from left, it would roll down the slope and go up on the opposite side to the same height from which it was released. So, what Galileo said, that when this marble is rolled down, how much it gets rolled down to that much height from where it has started rolling down to that much height on the another inclined plane, it climbs. Okay, so if the inclinations of the planes on both the sides are equal, then the marble will climb the same distance that it covered while rolling down. If the angle of inclination of the right side plane were gradually decreased, then the marble would travel further distances till it reaches the original height. If the right side plane were ultimately made horizontal, that is the slope is reduced to zero, then the marble would continue to travel forever trying to reach the same height that it was released from. So, these all the arguments are done by Galileo Galilei. But for all this, there must be an external unbalanced force acting. Okay, the unbalanced forces on the marble in this case are zero. It thus suggests that an unbalanced external force is required to change the motion of marble, but no net force is needed to sustain the uniform motion of the marble. But in practical situations, it is difficult to achieve a zero unbalanced force. This is because of the presence of frictional force acting opposite to the direction of motion. Thus, in practice, the marble stops after traveling some distance. The effect of the frictional force may be minimized by using smooth marble and smooth plane and providing a lubricant on the top of the planes. So, students, here just I have introduced you to the first law of motion. So, the first law of motion we are going to see in detail in the next lecture. So, today what we have seen is the type of forces we have discussed, that is balanced and unbalanced forces. If there are balanced forces, then there is no motion in the object, but if there are unbalanced forces, then the objects can move. So, it is all due to unbalanced forces. So, after discussing that, there are different laws which are put forth by the scientist. In that, the first law of motion is we are actually discussing. I have just introduced you with the help of that an activity. So, just try to do that activity at home, and I will discuss this first law of motion in more detail in the next session. Okay, here we will stop. Thank you.